This is The Allusionist, in which I, Helen Zaltzman, couldn't escape if I wanted to, Language Lou, knowing my fate is to be with you. This episode is about the language of the Eurovision Song Contest. Doesn't matter if you've never seen it, because the very concept of a nearly 70-year-old international multilingual televised song contest contains plenty to get your teeth into. But if you do want to get the gist, I'm sure you can find a veritable befuddlement of clips online. This is Eurovision Allusionist Part 1 of 2. On with the show. The Eurovision Song Contest has given us the international renown of Celine Dion, Måneskin, Dana International, Conchita Wurst, and Riverdance. It's given us tear-off skirts, nul-point, shiny, shiny costumes, a band of babushka dancing around an onstage bread oven, not to mention fraught politics within and between nations, and most importantly for our purposes, linguistic intrigue. So much linguistic intrigue.
My name is Dean Vuletic. I'm a historian of contemporary Europe and the author of the world's first scholarly study on the history of the Eurovision Song Contest.
What got you interested in Eurovision as a field of study?
Well, I grew up in Australia, the son of Croatian migrants, and we got to watch Eurovision already in the 1980s because of Australia's large non-English-speaking, as they called us, European migrant communities. There was a special television station set up for us called SBS, which offered multilingual broadcasting. And one of the shows that it broadcast from the 1980s was indeed the Eurovision Song Contest.
Explain for those who have never had the pleasure what the Eurovision Song Contest is.
The Eurovision Song Contest is one of the world's longest-running television shows. It was established in 1956 as an experiment in live, simultaneous transnational broadcasting, and it brings together countries which have national public service television stations that are members of the European Broadcasting Union, which is an association of national radio and television broadcasters from across Europe. And the European Broadcasting Union organizes Eurovision annually for its members. So basically what you see is songs, original songs, they have to be original according to the rules, representing countries on stage. And these countries are mostly European countries, but there are some exceptions, Israel and most recently Australia, for example.
Something that people whine about every year is the definition of Europe, since it includes, for contest purposes, Australia, Israel. How is Europe defined for the contest?
Well, for the contest, Europe is defined according to the technical area known as the European Broadcasting Area, which was established in the interwar period at a time when national radio broadcasters from across Europe were coming together to cooperate and, above all, to determine how to distribute radio frequencies among themselves, because the frequencies that were being used in different countries were often clashing, interfering with each other. So they really needed to cooperate to determine how they could organize the growing medium of radio across Europe.
They decided to come up with a definition of Europe based on latitude and longitude.
North Africa needed to be included there so that its radio frequencies wouldn't interfere with those of Spain or Italy or Malta. And that would go as far as Moscow to include the European part of the Soviet Union. So it was completely a technical definition.
But why Australia, you might ask? Because even with the stretchiest of technical definitions, Australia is not in Europe. Well, to celebrate Eurovision's 60th anniversary, in 2015, Australia was invited to compete as a special guest, because the song contest is such a popular TV event there. And the special guest has stuck around and competed nearly every year since. However, the inclusion of Australia actually fits in with the etymology of the event.
This term Eurovision, think about it. It's basically a synonym for Europe. So the term Europe comes from the Greek eur, meaning broad, and the op, to see. So Eurovision, with vision being the Latin for to see, essentially means the same thing as Europe.
Oh my God.
Yes.
What a portmanteau.
Exactly.
Was that deliberate though, or were they just saying, we've got televisions now, let's reflect that?
No, it wasn't deliberate. Yeah, I think it just comes from television because Eurovision was the name given to the Eurovision Network, which was established by the EBU in 1954. To promote the exchange of television programs among the EBU's members. It was a name that was coined by a British journalist and then caught on to become the name of the network. You know, you have a fresh idea of what Europe should be after the Second World War and that it needs to integrate. So then this, let's say, more unified concept of Europe also comes out in the language.
But as well as the vision substituting for the op component of Europe that meant see, the vision is there to remind you that even though it's supposedly a singing show, looking at it is more important than listening to it. After all, it's not a radio broadcast, is it?
The main motivation behind Eurovision has always been to produce a television show. So this was why it was created in the mid-1950s as an experiment in television technology. You know, the people behind Eurovision, the officials from the EBU in the mid-1950s, thought that it would be great as an experiment in television to see if they could broadcast live and simultaneously and transnationally a common television show. So the popular music was basically just... It was a way of making a television program more attractive than, let's say, if you had a script that you would then have to translate and you would have to work out ways, you know, for different audiences to understand it. Popular music was an easier way to do it. Music is universal. Even if you have the songs in different languages, people could still relate to the sounds, the beats. Until then, soccer had been the most successful transnational program in the EBU's attempts, but this was a way to try with a different format. So really, you know, the idea of the television show is what has always been central to Eurovision and to the organizers of Eurovision. The music, the singing is less of a priority.
I just feel like such a dupe. Just played into their hands. Nonetheless, I'm going to prioritise the songs because the songs have to have lyrics, that's compulsory, instrumentals are not allowed, and lyrics are made of language, and language, in a multilingual, international singing show, is wrapped up in a whole lot of political, economic and cultural factors. The rules have changed several times regarding the languages in which a country can perform. Although when the Eurovision Song Contest began in 1956, there were no language rules.
And it was just assumed that every country participating would want to sing in its own language in order to showcase its national culture.
Did they?
Yes, they did, until 1965, when the Swedish entry dared to sing in English, and that's when the language rule was introduced.
Why was it so controversial for Sweden to have sent a song in English?
So it was controversial simply because this hadn't been done before. No one had experimented or challenged the status quo by not singing in their national language. And the rules had until then said that Eurovision should be a stage upon which the different national cultures are promoted, but there was no distinct rule insisting that songs be in the national language of the country that the song is representing.
At the first contest, there were only 7 countries competing, but this number grew year after year. There were 18 competitors by 1965, when Sweden performed in English so seismically. It's okay, though, they only came 10th. The winner that year was Luxembourg, with a song written by Serge Gainsbourg, Poupée de cire, poupée de son, French for wax doll, rag doll. At that point of the Eurovision Song Contest's existence, French had been the most popular language to perform in, and the one most likely to win.
Yes, because there were a lot of French-speaking countries participating. So, of course, France, Belgium, Switzerland, Monaco and Luxembourg, neither of which have been in Eurovision for a long time now. But there was a Francophone bloc. And this also meant that in the first 10 years of Eurovision, 6 of the winning entries were in French. And that also prompted some of the earliest scandals, the earliest controversies in Eurovision regarding block voting, because the Nordic countries especially were critical of the Francophone countries for what the Nordic countries thought was block voting. So the Francophone countries supporting each other in the voting. But actually it was more of a case of there being more French language entries in Eurovision than entries in other languages.
From almost the beginning of the Eurovision Song Contest, little bits of other languages had snuck into the songs.
There had been some experimentation with songs introducing some words or phrases from different languages, especially from Romance languages. So already in 1957, we see the West German entry, Telefon, Telefon, which used two gimmicks that became popular in Eurovision, trying to broaden the sonorous appeal of a Eurovision entry to an international audience. And that song, Telefon, Telefon, first of all, used an international word, telefon, which can be understood by a very wide audience, an audience which doesn't even understand German. And then there were a lot of words used from other languages, such as French and Italian, you know, Spanish as well, phrases from languages that are internationally well known. Chérie, bonsoir, amore, amor, words like that.
But when the rule came in from 1966 that a country's entries had to be in one of its national languages, they could no longer sneak chérie into a German song, for example. But only until 1972, when they removed the national languages rule again.
Well, one of the reasons was because the Nordic countries, they always felt that they were disadvantaged in Eurovision by having to sing in their national languages, which they thought did not sound too appealing to an international audience, the Finns especially. I went through the archives of the European Broadcasting Union and the discussions within the decision-making body of the organization regarding Eurovision, and it came out that the Nordic countries were most often the ones calling for a change to the language rule.
Another reason for removing the compulsory national languages rule was that in the late 1960s and early 70s, Eurovision was not as popular as the EBU would have liked, especially with young people.
And the EBU was quite concerned about this because it basically meant that if the contest wasn't going to be watched by more young people, then its future was going to be really questioned. Already we could hear the same criticisms of Eurovision being made then as are still made now. The fact that it costs too much, it is, let's say, producing music or showcasing music that is not up to date or in tune with contemporary trends, and that the voting is rigged. So too expensive, poor quality, and rigged voting.
Oh, not much then.
No, not much. And so these criticisms were coming up in the European media very often, and the EBU really thought that it needed to make Eurovision a much more modern and attractive event for it to be able to continue.
And one of their ways to do this was to ditch the rule whereby acts had to perform in one of their national languages,
with the implication being that more songs would be sung in English, which was at that time already the language of popular music, the international language of popular music, and also to change other rules of the contest that would allow for more modern, let's say, bands and musical instrumentation to appear on the Eurovision stage. So it was all about making Eurovision more funky, more fashionable, more of the time.
Did it work?
Not really, because the problem was that then from 1973 to 1976, when the language rule was abrogated, there were three wins in the English language, which caused concern among some members of the European Broadcasting Union, because then they felt that this contest was just going to be dominated by English language songs. Of course, one of the big entries to come out in that period was ABBA's Waterloo, representing Sweden in 1974, which went on to win the contest and to be the biggest ever Eurovision hit to ever come out of the contest. Until then, can you guess which was the biggest hit to have come out of Eurovision? Volare. Domenico Modugno singing Volare.
Cantare. Oh my God, Volare.
Volare, exactly.
Sorry, I know the song isn't even called Volare. It's called Nel Blu Dipinto di Blu, which roughly translates from Italian as In the Blue, Painted Blue. But who's going to remember that trippy title inspired by Marc Chagall's paintings when you've got... Oh, oh, oh. The song didn't win Eurovision in 1958, it came third, but it did score Billboard's Song of the Year, and the following year, at the first ever Grammy Awards, it won the award for Song of the Year. It's still the only Eurovision song ever to win a Grammy. The song remains one of the most successful Italian language pop hits of all time. We're just going to take a quick break, not for Riverdance, but for ads. The Allusionist is sponsored by Bombas, makers of the comfiest, breathablest socks, t-shirts and undies. I'm feeling springy right now, which for me is a mixture of invigoration at the fresh, bright little leaves on the trees and the blossoming. And dread at the prospect of the sweaty months ahead. But at least I'm prepared for those on my soles. My foot sweat will be politely wicked away by my Bombas no-show socks. And because a sock as small as a no-show does have a little propensity for not showing up in my sock drawer, sometimes when I do unearth them, it's a fresh surprise. I had forgotten I had a pair of the cushioned no-shows, and they are like walking on a soft bed of moss. Oh, lovely. Also, if you lose one of your socks and it does not reappear, get in touch with Bombas's happiness team, because they may be able to supply you with a replacement. Go to bombas.com/allusionist and use the code allusionist for 20% off your first purchase. That's bombas.com/allusionist and use the code allusionist at checkout. Thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring The Allusionist. And because I like to treat myself, I've just been reading Squarespace's freshly released Environmental, Social and Governance report to check in on how things are going there and how they treat their employees. In 2022, Squarespace landed on several lists of the best places to work, and I'm glad to see that they mention remote work inclusivity and that they offer cover for employees' fertility treatment and gender-affirming medical care. It's easy to forget that behind your user-friendly one-stop shop for building and running your own beautifully designed website, there are about 1,800 staff working away. But there are, so it's good to know that, as workplaces go, Squarespace is a care place, not a scare space. And if you have any scares while using the service, or more likely only the mildest of perplexities, then Squarespace offers 24/7 customer support via live chat or email in 6 languages. Go to squarespace.com/allusionist for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, use the offer code allusionist to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Now back to the Eurovision Song Contest with Dean Vuletic. Anyway, after English language songs won in 1974, 1975 and 1976, in 1977, the Eurovision Song Contest brought back the rule that it was compulsory for a country to perform its entry in one of its official national languages. Therefore, only the United Kingdom, Ireland and Malta were allowed to perform in English.
The languages winning were much more diverse. Different languages were winning the contest. It wasn't all just about the French or about the English. You know, there was a mix going on there. Hebrew, for example, in the late 1970s. Then we had also some Nordic wins, Norway, Sweden. There were some French language wins.
Between 1977 and 1991, only two winners were in English, both by Ireland. But then from 1992, things got all a bit Englishy. 1992, Ireland wins, United Kingdom comes second. 1993, Ireland wins, United Kingdom comes second. 1994, Ireland wins. 1996, Ireland wins. 1997, United Kingdom wins, Ireland comes second. 1998, United Kingdom comes second. All of these songs were in English, and Malta's English entries finished in the top 10 in every one of those years too. So in 1999, the EBU got rid of the national languages rule again, because if songs in English were more likely to win, at least then different countries would have a chance of winning with them. And indeed, in 1999, Sweden won with a song in the English language, Take Me to Your Heaven.
And so basically from the early 1990s, most of the wins have been in English. Since the abrogation of the language rule, since 1999, there have only been four entries that haven't been in English that have won. The Serbian entry Molitva in 2007, the Portuguese entry in 2017, the Italian entry sung by Maneskin, Zitti e Buoni, in 2021, and last year's Ukrainian entry, Stefania. So English really has dominated Eurovision, both in terms of wins and in the number of entries that have been performed in English since 1999.
And Dean thinks this is a big problem for Eurovision.
Why? Because first of all, Eurovision is losing one of its guiding aims to promote different cultures from across Europe. You know, that was how the contest was conceived. The second is that Eurovision isn't upholding the values of diversity that the EBU has come to attach to the contest in the last decade. Social diversity has become more of a value in Eurovision in the last decade, but linguistic diversity has been forgotten as a value. And I think this is something that Eurovision really needs to embrace again. And I think it's something that the viewing public is really embracing. So very interestingly, even though the organizers of Eurovision, I think, in the last two decades have thought, well, let's let songs be in English because that will make the contest more popular, what's happening now is that people are actually more attracted to Eurovision because they want to see and hear this linguistic diversity. Younger people are more exposed to different cultures and different languages, and I think that they're wanting to see a Eurovision in which this diversity is really promoted. But here again, you're getting into this tension that has historically existed in Eurovision. They don't want these national public service broadcasters just pitching an entry that might be commercially successful and hence in English. They want something of their cultures to appear on the Eurovision stage. They want some authenticity. They want a message being sent. And I think this is the new wave that we're now seeing in Eurovision. And I think it's a very hopeful and inspiring wave.
Since 1999, there have been no rules about which languages countries can perform in.
But that doesn't mean that we haven't had controversies regarding the languages of entries in Eurovision. We've had movements that have put pressure on the entries to be sung in the national languages. Let's say, you know, on the very rare occasions when the entries of Spain or France have not been in their national languages, there has been a political backlash. And quickly, the national broadcasters have reverted back to having entries in their languages. There are some countries in which there is really no debate about whether a song should be in any language other than the national language. So you see some countries being very consistent in this. Portugal, for example, France and Spain, as I mentioned, some countries of the Balkans, where the trend is for them to sing in their own languages, such as Serbia. And then there are other countries where it is just expected that the entries will be in English. Germany, for example, the Nordic countries. Not always, but most of the time, the Nordic countries still think that international audiences are not going to respond as well to their languages as they will to entries in English.
You know who else has only ever done Eurovision songs in English? The United Kingdom. never in any of the other languages of the region. No Scots, Gaelic, Cornish, BSL, Welsh. Although Welsh language songs have at least appeared a few times at the Junior Eurovision when Wales has participated.
But yeah, generally speaking, this is not something that's done. It's not a part of British cultural policy to promote this regional diversity.
No.
As much as it has been seen, let's say, in French entries or even Italian entries.
I was very interested that last year France's entry was in Breton, because France itself usually likes to promote the French language pretty hard.
It does, but there was a turn in the cultural politics of France in the 1990s where regional identities came to be promoted more also in the official cultural policy. And this was also reflected then in France's Eurovision entries when songs were sung in regional languages or even sung by performers who had immigrant roots from North Africa especially. So we already see this multilingual, multicultural turn in France's Eurovision entries in the 1990s.
And there have been some entries in constructed languages.
Yes, there have been a few, and most of them were sent by Belgium.
Belgium's already got so many languages to deal with.
Well, this is the problem. I think this was a way of Belgium dealing with its own linguistic politics, or at least a subtle message. And I think this is also one of the reasons why Belgian entries often tend to be performed in English, because then you just don't have this issue. Also, perhaps the Flemish might not be as confident in their language appealing to an international audience as much as the Francophone Walloons have an advantage singing in French in this regard. But here, the fact that we're getting more countries singing their own languages again will challenge these stereotypes of, you know, some languages not sounding as attractive or as musical as others. I can say from my personal experience, watching the performance last year of the Dutch entry in Dutch live in the arena in which Eurovision was held with a predominantly Italian audience, the way that the audience responded, applauded this performance in the Dutch language was inspiring. It was touching, you know, it was such a beautiful emotional song. So I think, you know, that this idea that Germanic languages don't sound as emotional as Romance ones, I think that that really doesn't fly. I think you can express a lot of different emotions as well, or a lot of different nuances, ideas in different languages. So I really think that each country should try to harness the power of its own language in Eurovision in order to do well in Eurovision.
In the next installment of Eurovision Allusionist, dictators, protests, and boom bang a bang ding a dong diggy loo diggy lay. For providing background information about the Eurovision Song Contest and recommending Dean Vuletic to me, I must thank Ewan Spence of escinsight.com, the podcast and website for all things Eurovision. He also happens to be responsible for me getting into podcasting in the first place, because in 2006, he interviewed Ollie Mann for a podcast. Ollie Mann thought, well, this is just a guy with a recorder. I could be just a guy with a recorder. And decided to do a podcast and asked me to do it with him. Answer Me This was born and lived for nearly 15 years. And this week was reborn for a special episode, which you can listen to now for all you've ever or never wanted to know about dogs eating snotty tissues, unkosher birds, how Danielle Steele writes 7 novels per year, and checking your own semen under a microscope. It's available at answermethispodcast.com and on the pod places. And while you're frequenting said pod places, listen to the recent episode of Drunk Women Solving Crime featuring me, despite being a teetotal gender unsubscribed non-detective, pondering a long ago murder on a train. If you have any spare coins, I can transform those into independent podcasts for you. Trot over to theallusionist.org/donate, and in return for your contribution to the running of the show, you get to hear all about how the pod sausage is made, you get regular live streams with chat and music and dictionaries, and you get to hang out with your fellow Illusionauts in the Illusiverse Discord community, the loveliest place on the internet. This week, we have been discussing vampirates in the Portmanteau channel and learning the etymology of mint julep, as well as working through some of our stresses with family members. And I am thrilled to note our regular dose of special spoons has evolved to include special cups. Maybe I can escalate it to special tongs next. I have at least two pairs. Anyway, join us for the good times at theillusionist.org/donate. Your randomly selected word from the dictionary today is ruelle. Noun, the space between a bed and the wall, a bedchamber where aristocratic French women held receptions in the 17th and 18th centuries, a morning reception, in France, a narrow lane. Origin French, diminutive of rue, street. Try using ruelle in an email today. This episode was produced by me, Helen Zaltzman. The original music is by Martin Austwick. Happy birthday to Ashra, who does the Inwitches at inwitches.tumblr.com. You heard from historian Dean Vuletic, author of the book Postwar Europe and the Eurovision Song Contest. There'll be more from Dean next episode. And with this year's contest ramping up ahead of the final on 13th of May, this is Dean's busy period for talking about Eurovision, so you can keep up with his media appearances, as well as the rest of his work, at deanvuletic.com. Our ad partner is Multitude. If you have a product or thing about which you'd like me to talk lovingly and winningly, contact Multitude at multitude.productions/ads. Seek out Allusionist Show on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook and Twitter. And you can hear or read every episode, find links to more information about the topics and people therein, see the full dictionary entries for all of the randomly selected words, and browse a lexicon of every word covered in the podcast, all at the show's forever home, theillusionist.org.